overhaul and a go status.
T-minus 30 seconds.
The morning mayhem.
TPA script running. Second stage LH2 securing started.
Ready for launch?
Ready to embark on a national security mission for the United States of America.
Newsock 92.
Range green.
Igniters armed. Rofi ignition.
KBU.
4, 3, and liftoff.
The morning mayhem is on.
Expected.
The Morning Mayhem is pre-recorded and for entertainment purposes only.
I think it's time to blow this scene. Get everybody in the stuff together. Okay, 3, 2, 1, let's jam.
And let's jam here on this here Friday morning, everybody. Yes, sir, we have finally made it to Friday. And, of course, you know, we still got stuff to talk about as well. Words still have meanings, and we're seeing that play out on social media. Juneteenth celebrations are beginning today, and Washtenaw County celebrates Judge Philip J. Foster's retirement and reflects on the impact that he's had on the community. 21 recruits graduate to become state troopers, and Pine Bluff woman beaten and robbed by a man that she met on social media. We'll talk about that. Bismarck School Board blasted at a recent school board meeting. And online meetings will discuss Arkansas electric vehicle infrastructure plans and some of the top selling items that are sold at Walmart in Arkansas. What about Texas? All that and more. News Talk 92 KBEU, the news and talk of South Arkansas. News Talk 92 KBEU, the news and talk of South Arkansas. Good morning, everybody, here on this Friday morning as we are kicking off this weekend. And, boys, it's going to be a long weekend at that, too, because there's going to be lots and lots and lots of stuff going on out there. 74 degrees right now. Feels like 83 out there. Going to see a high 97 and possibly a little chance of some rains out there and stuff. But, yeah. Real quick, though, yeah, the stuff that's going on this weekend, starting today at 6 p.m. downtown Camden, it's the Juneteenth Parade, and that'll be followed by the Bridging the Gap Block Party at Ira Clark Park. Say that five times fast. Ira Clark Park, 6 p.m. today. That's today. Then tomorrow, Saturday, June 18th, all day long, going to be jamming in the park. There'll be vendors out there, bouncy houses and food and booths and all kinds of things. Organizations out there trying to recruit you to get to do stuff. If you're not registered to vote, that would be one organization that would be out there helping you get registered to vote. And, of course, there'll always be some kind of games out there to play as well. Then on Sunday, June 19th, at 3 p.m., it's the car show. It's the Juneteenth car show going out there. And don't forget, June 19th, not only is Juneteenth, but it's also Father's Day. So they just happen to fall on the same day there. And also with Juneteenth being on a Sunday, that means, and I forgot about this too, because, you know, this is our second year that Juneteenth is now a federal holiday. Who knew? Well, if you were paying attention last year, you would have known. When Biden took office, that was one of the first things he did was make Juneteenth a federal holiday. So, as of course, federal holidays that fall on a weekend are observed either on typically on a Monday. So anything, pretty much any government agency, you can expect to not be open for Monday on June 20th. And it's probably going to include your banks and also your financial institutions as well. So keep those in mind as you go on about your day Monday. And a lot of y'all are going to end up getting the day off too. So that's a 3-day weekend for some of y'all out there. As for us, no, radio doesn't get to, we're very limited on what 3-day holidays we get to have and what 3-day holidays we do have. We cherish them very much, but Juneteenth is not one of them. So we're not going to get to partake in that. But we will be broadcasting live, though. Tonight, though, we will be broadcasting from the Gazebo Fest. Oh, I forgot. Yeah, that's going on tonight, too. The Gazebo Festival is going on down in Bearden today and Saturday as well. So that's a 2-day weekend celebration. So we'll be there tonight broadcasting live from there. And then We'll be broadcasting from, where are we going to be at? Carnes Park on Saturday, June 18th. And we'll be broadcasting live from there down at Parnes Park from 10... Carnes Park. It's too early, man. Carnes Park down there from 10:30 to 12:30. And then I think we're taking the rest of the week off. And then I'll be over at the Country Club for a private event for the Back to the 90s party. I think you could still get tickets. They're like $50. It's to help raise money and stuff for First Friday, because First Friday is needing some money for fun stuff. They're replacing stuff like, they got their tent that they need to replace. They got, they're wanting to purchase some sound equipment and things like that for doing announcements and other things. So they're raising money for that. And then they got some other things that that they need to get replaced and fixed because, well, things wear out over time. And so all this goes towards the First Friday Committee, and that helps them to be able to continue doing what they're doing. So if you love doing the First Friday Market thing downtown every first Friday of the month in Camden, that's what these funds help do. Help keep that thing going. So if you want to, make a date and a plan to go out there for that, it's $50 a ticket. But hey, it's for a good cause, and it includes dinner too. So I believe it's dinner, cocktail, and dance, and even some karaoke out there as well. So it's going to be lots of fun. And that's pretty much all we got lined up for the weekend out there. So other things going on, I was looking at the podcast yesterday. I mean, podcast took off because we were talking about, we were doing the roundup for Smackover Norflet School District and the whole thing with Tammy Phil, y'all, and the outcome of that. And we talked a little bit about how words have meanings. And they do, man. They have an impact because when you look at the situation with Tammy Phil, y'all, and not to rehash anything, I'm actually using this to get into something else. But when you look at the impact of what words mean, and when you say that somebody's had an inappropriate relationship with a student, you think student is a minor, and you're thinking the teacher is an adult. So when you think student, especially in a high school setting, you're thinking somebody under 18. And the first thing that goes into your mind is a physical or sexual contact. And it's not always the case, but like I said, words have meaning. And if you want to hint that message without saying that message, then you can relay that message of what somebody infers when you use a certain combination of words. And, there's intent on that because you're trying to say it without saying it. So when somebody goes, I can't believe it, I didn't say that. I just said that it's an inappropriate relationship with a student, which means that the student and the teacher are meeting outside of school hours and doing this, that, and that, and this, and what have you. And anyhow, and it's the same thing with the Camden Police Department, because I ended up talking with Chief yesterday. Chief Bo Woody came over, and we had a little chit chat for a little bit and talking about the impact of words. And, I finally got a little bit more precise about what is it with this guy. Because I'm like, I can understand, like, if this was just, like, last week, a couple days ago or something like that, then, yeah, you could probably say former employee. But the way it's worded is it's a former Camden police officer. And that's where I'm confused, because I'm like, well, wait a minute. Is he really a police officer? Or I mean, how far did this thing go? And so come to find out, the guy signed up, he passed through the agility test, he got through the Civil Service Commission and everything else. They did a background check on him. But the thing was, though, was at the time, none of this stuff was on his record because none of it had popped yet. So how can you run a background check to find criminal activity on somebody if they haven't committed the crime yet? Or they may have already committed the crime, but with that, they haven't been popped yet or charged with it yet. Or discovered yet. So even though they may have already done it, that doesn't mean that it's going to pop until, it's official. And then you've got, then you've got an arrest. You got an incident report. You've got an arrest report. And then, now you've got court records to explain everything that's going on, right? So former Camden police officer charged with rape of a minor. So I went and looked, and I'm seeing all the comments, and everybody's like losing their mind because they're like, oh my gosh, how could, the police department, what is up with with our police department. You know, how in the world did he even get to be a police officer in the first place? Well, what's going on? And then the other ones are, you know, why didn't they do a background check? Why didn't they do this? Why didn't they do that? Any fool knows, you know, he was hired, and any fool would not miss the point either, you know. And let's see, other ones, you know, is this what kind of people we hire to protect and serve? What's going on with this here? So, I mean, it's a feeding frenzy. And it's all based on the wording, police officer. But come to find out, he was never actually a police officer. Because when you think of a police officer, what do you think of? Like I said, words have meanings. When somebody tells you that a teacher has had an inappropriate relationship with a student, what do you think of? Student being under the age of 18, the teacher being an adult with a position of power and authority, and inappropriate relationship. You think relationship. Relationship always goes back to some type of romance of some sort. But there's different levels of relationship, just like there's different levels of love. I mean, love doesn't mean just the one thing, you know. There's different ways of using love in a sentence, and it's all in context. But if you take it out of context, a relationship can mean God knows what. And it's like, oh, my God, what is going on over there? Oh, over there in Smackover, they've got teachers having relations with students. And it's like, no, that's not what anybody's saying. They're just saying it was an inappropriate relationship. Well, define inappropriate. Now we start getting into definitions, and we put it back into context. Same thing with this here, former Camden police officer. So how can you be a police officer if you were never certified and never sworn in? You can't be a police officer. So then that would have to mean that either the only way to get this information would be that Waldron had to identify as a police officer. If he said, like, well, you know who I am. I used to be a Camden police officer, which means now he's impersonating a police officer. Or somebody didn't do their homework and just went ahead and slapped a title on there and goes, you know, let's just make him a cop anyways. There you go. So now he's a cop. Which means that somebody didn't do their homework, because in reality, what he ended up becoming was a rookie or a cadet or an employee of the Camden Police Department, because he was in the first steps of, you know, following through to become a police officer. So first thing you got to do is go get an application and you fill it out. That doesn't make you a police officer. Sorry. Does that make you a police officer? No, just because you fill out an application, you can't go home and tell your mom, like, I became a complaints officer today. No, that doesn't work. So you fill out the application, you turn it in, they talk to you, and they say they want to hire you. Does that make you a police officer? No, still not a police officer, not yet. So then you go before the civil service, and then you do the agility test and everything else. You pass the flying colors, and they say, yeah, we want this guy. Are you a police officer? No, not yet. So then you kind of hang around and wait for your turn to go to Alita. And so now you're at Alita, right? And you pass Alita with flying colors and everything. And they say, congratulations, you have graduated. And now you're off to be a police officer. Are you a police officer now? No, not yet. You're still a rookie, because you have to at least serve 1 year after Alita to officially be a certified police officer. So now, after 1 year after Alita, you do all the things that you're supposed to do, and then you finally do your 1 year of all that, and then you get certified, you get sworn in and certified. Do you get to be a police officer? Yes, you do. Congratulations. Yes, you have now become officially a police officer. Yes. But he was only there for like 3 weeks. So, hanging around inside a police station, does that make you a police officer? No, it does not. Getting tased for fun at the Citizens Police Academy, does that make you certified to be able to operate and hold a taser? No, it does not. Because I already asked. I was like, hey, wait a minute, man. Like, you know, those guys, they got tased for their certification and everything. And I got tased too. So I went to Chief Bo Woody and I said, hey, where's my taser? And they're like, yeah, you don't get one. And I'm like, why not, man? Because they said, you're not certified. We can't be just handing out tasers to everyone who gets tased, or else there'd be a lot of criminals walking around with tasers. I'm like, okay, fine, whatever. I mean, you win this round. Okay. So words have meaning. So when you say former Camden police officer, why didn't they go back? Because, I mean, he was in the National Guard. So why didn't they say former National Guard? Whatever officer or dude gets arrested. When they arrested him, he was registered as a student over at SAU in Magnolia. So why didn't they say SAU student in Magnolia arrested on charged with rape of a minor, held on no bond? What's the whole idea of linking it back to the Camden Police Department? So why is this putting the Camden Police Department in a spotlight for a guy who hung around for 3 weeks? So does that mean now that anybody who fills out an application gets to hang out in the building? And while they're waiting on all the other paperwork and everything else to come through to be processed and stuff, does that mean that Camden Police Department is just not doing their job because of, you know, things haven't popped yet on a background check, or they haven't, you know, been charged with a crime just yet? So they're not doing their job? I mean, I don't know. The thing is, though, is he was just there for 3 weeks. He was an employee. And he was wanting to become an officer, but he didn't become an officer. So what's the point of using the headline, Camden, former Camden police officer charged with rape of a minor? To sell papers. That's pretty much it. Sell papers. And it worked because you guys are talking about him. You guys are going on a frenzy on Facebook about it. And y'all are bashing the Camden Police Department about it. And it worked. So there's some papers that got sold. So congratulations out there. I mean, that's how you do it. That is how you do it. When it comes to sales, baby, ABC, ABC, baby, always be closing to get the Ginzu knife set. All right, I got to take this break. We'll be right back. News Talk 92, KBEU, the news and talk of South Arkansas. News Talk 92, KBEU, the news and talk of South Arkansas. As we are coming up on the bottom of the 674 degrees outside. Feels like 83 out there. High 97. It's Juneteenth weekend, baby. A weekend of celebration. Don't forget, the Gazebo Festival is going on this weekend as well out there in Bearden. So we've got all kinds. Don't say there's nothing to do around here, because there is plenty and lots to do. So if you can't decide which one you want to do, go do them all. Make yourself a little itinerary and figure out what it is you want to do, where you want to be, and how you want to do it, and how much time you want to spend at each event, and that way you can get a little bit of everything. See, a little smorgasbord of all the fun activities here for this weekend. Juneteenth will be going on starting today all the way into Sunday. You got the Gazebo Festival starting today and going into Saturday, and then of course you got the 90s dance party that's going on tonight over at the Camden Country Club thing that's over there. So yeah, there's all kinds of stuff going on. $50 ticket, get you food, cocktails, and some entertainment, and all proceeds are going towards the First Friday Committee. So just before the break, we were talking about, you know, why do we word things the way that we do? And not to keep beating a dead horse here, but yeah, it was to sell papers. ABC. Always be closing, because it's all about sales. And not only that, though, when I was taking real estate, one of the required courses that I had to take was contract law. And when it came to contract law, one of the things I picked up on was words do have meaning. It's not what you say. It's the words that you use that define what it is that's going to be carried out. God forbid, should you ever have to go before a judge, and then a judge has to decide, how this contract is going to play out. And it has everything to do with words. Like the difference between will and shall. Will means, voluntarily. I mean, yeah, you could do it or you could not do it. But shall means you're going to do it. So typically you would probably say something like, somebody will, do this thing. You will do this thing. And if it goes before a judge, well, will has a different meaning than shall. Will means that, they can voluntarily decide to do what you're requesting of them or not. So it's on them. Whereas if you say you shall do this thing, there's no getting out of it. I mean, that's one of the simplest things that I could say that people can understand. So, when it comes to media, I've done it too for personal gain. So, I mean, I'm not going to sit there and harp on the paper and be like, shame on you. For shame on what you did. I saw what you did there. Yeah, I did it too. And, I ended up in court for it. But that was the whole idea. We were trying to get into court because the court wouldn't listen to us. And the court was like, we're done with you. And they didn't want anything to do with us anymore. So we figured the best way to get back into court is to get their attention and make them come back to court or make them bring us back to court. And it worked basically by saying through someone else or quoting someone else that we indicted a judge. And we got the judge's attention. Next thing you know, hey, look at this. They actually want to hear us. Oh, I tell you. Okay, so that's how it works. Sometimes, you know, we didn't mean to harm anybody, but, you know, someone else said it. I didn't say it. I was basically just quoting what someone else said. And that person was present to make sure that if anybody questioned it, that person who said it was there to go, yes, I did say that. And it wasn't me. I was just quoting what that other person said. So I didn't do it. That person did it. But that person was also out of jurisdiction of the court. So see, so we kind of manipulated the system to say, all right, this guy is going to say it, but he's outside the jurisdiction of the court. So the court can't even touch him. So we're putting everything on him to make it to where we're going to quote him and then we'll get the court's attention. And sure enough, boy, do we get the court's attention. And then after that, because the way we spun it and the way we did our typical media thing. And it's the words that you use and how you say it, that there was nothing the court could do against us because we did what we were supposed to do. And we played it by the book, but we also manipulated it by the book to get what we needed out of it. So, I mean, I'm not going to sit here and be all high and mighty and everything about it and be like, can't believe y'all did that. Yeah, I've done it too, where I've needed to get somebody's attention. And it works. Look, it got your attention. You're like, well, I can't believe the Camden Police Department would hire a pedophile. That's crazy. What kind of fire department are we? Fire department. What kind of police department are we running here? What kind of railroad you got here, Bo Woody? What are y'all doing over here? And not only that, though, it's political season, too. So you got a mayor that's up for re-election. And sure, why not? You know, create some controversy there. It's like, wow, you know, the mayor's in charge of the police department. And the police department is hiring. So that must mean that, you know, take it all the way to the top. So that must mean that the mayor is dropping the ball. And so that's where the buck stops, right? So then that must mean that the mayor is not enforcing what the police department should be doing or cracking down on a police. See, you can sit there and spin it however you need to. But that's the thing. Words have meaning, and we got played by it, and we've done it twice now. And speaking of courts and judges and everything, guess what? Well, yesterday, they shut down the whole court system and everything to honor Judge Philip J. Foster, everybody. Yeah. He's retired or retiring, but yeah, he's retiring. But yesterday they had a moment to where Judge Foster got to sit in a big, you know, cool looking chair, felt chair and everything. And people came up and everything started with city attorney Michael Fry opening up the ceremony and everything. And then after that, people came up one by one and your court clerk, Vic. Well, we call her Vic. Vicky came up. And pretty much emceed everything, man. She did a great job, by the way. Just want to say, man, Vic, you did a great job on that. She puts a lot of work into things that goes on in that courtroom, and she's been doing it now for 18 years, and she just does not get the recognition that she deserves because she does so much behind the scenes that makes that place run as smooth as it does. And if it weren't for her, you wouldn't even realize how smooth everything runs through there. I want to pick up on that on the other side. I've got to take this break as we hit the bottom of the hour here. We'll continue on and some of the special guests that made their appearance, too, to say congratulations to Judge Foster. News Talk 92 KBEU, the news and talk of South Arkansas, coming out of bottom of the six here. Yeah, Vic just checked in. Victoria Huggins, you may know her. And she says, oh my goodness, you're just too sweet. But she says, you know what? She just can't do it. She can't get it. She's nothing without her A-team, is what she said. So it's not just her, but it's all the other people that are behind her that help her out on her team that make everything as smooth as it is. And yesterday was awesome. the celebration that they gave for Judge Foster as he says, so long, farewell, Velveeta cheese, good night. And also unveiling the picture of Judge Foster in the courtroom. That was also another reason why we were there, was for the unveiling of his photo that now hangs in district court. And so punch and cake was had, and punch and cake was awesome. Had some of that passion punch. That was good. I liked that. And then you had your choice of chocolate or vanilla cake. And I'm like, I didn't know. So Vic was like, here, have both. And I'm like, oh, okay. So, all right. I can't decide. So sure, why not? Not like I need both. Not like I even needed either one to begin with. Because, you know, I'm trying to watch my girlish figure for bikini season or Speedo season. Yeah, you don't want to see that either. But yeah. So anyhow, had the ceremony yesterday and everything was awesome. And Michael Fry, your city attorney, started everything out. And with that, he opened everything and the ceremonies and stuff. And then after that, one by one, they all started coming up and they all gave their little memories and some stories and stuff about things that they remember with Judge Foster. And, you know, Judge Foster had a lot of stuff, other stuff going on before he was a judge. Now, he did attorney school and everything, so he was also a practicing attorney, but also he worked with Century 21 and did real estate and stuff like that. And then also with the bank, which I can't remember the evolving names of the bank that finally became Generations Bank. But the ladies of the court, Vic and her A-team up there, which is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 members along with Vic. They gave their thank yous and appreciations and how, because of Judge Foster and how compassionate he is and how fair he is and how just he is. And Vic shared a story, which was really heartfelt, about a gentleman. I believe he was in his 90s. He was a veteran and he wasn't in the best of health and he was kind of, you could say, on his way out, but he ended up getting a traffic infraction, and he's never had a ticket in his life. And so he wanted to keep it that way. He was willing to pay the fine. You know, I'll take care of it, whatever, just please. He threw himself at the mercy of the court and he said, please, just whatever you do, keep this off my record. I've come this far without anything on my record, and I would like to go and leave the world this way as well. So, I mean, whatever fine I need to pay, I pay it. Just please keep it off my record. And explained that he even had his hat, too. He had his cover in his hand and everything while he was there at the podium talking to Judge Foster and explaining that he was a veteran. And, you know, he's never done anything like this before. He's not in the best of health and you know, he's not long for the world, but doesn't want to leave this world with something like that on his record. He just wants to have a clean record. So with that, Judge Foster said that his debt is paid in full and not to worry about it and to enjoy the rest of his day and go on. And so it was things like that that Vic was talking about, that the compassion and the fairness and things like that that Judge Foster had brought to the courtroom when it came to dealing with people and even those who did wrong and needed to pay their debt to society. They were saying, a lot of people were saying that Judge Foster was even fair with that too. And, that, you know, people got what they had coming to them. And then, Judge McAdoo, your county judge, made a proclamation, for June 16th and honored Judge Foster as well. And then, Buckshot got up and spoke as well. And that was the other thing too. If you've ever gone to a district court, Buckshot has served, for court for the longest time. And so, Buckshot would bring everything into order. And then, you know, the whole thing, you know, everybody's hanging out in the courtroom and, you know, chit chatting and stuff and gossiping and whatever and talking. And then all of a sudden you hear, that voice that belts out to tell you, to get your attention and tell you to all rise, the honorable such and such. Is presiding, and then, you know, you stand up, the judge comes in, and then the judge sits down and does his thing, and then you hear that voice say, you may be seated, and everybody sits down. Well, that's what Buckshot did. And Buckshot,
I'm sitting there thinking, man, you know, buckshot. Buckshot doesn't hold that much power. Because, I mean, you know, when you're talking about ranking, he doesn't hold that much power compared to, you know, when you're talking about when it comes to ranks, right? But boy, could he control that room. He did, man. He told everybody, stand up. And everybody, like, did it. And he said, sit down. And everybody, like, sat down. And he could sit there and go, Simon says jump on one foot. Everybody would be jumping on one foot just because it's Buckshot. I was thinking to myself that I'm like, you know, Buckshot really doesn't have that much command when it comes to rank. I mean, he has some, but not anything, you know, where he can just, he's not like a chief. He's not like a judge where he can, you know, command that level of authority, but he does. And people do it. And that's what cracked me up. I was like, only Buckshot, which brought me back to the whole thing about, you know, when I went into court last month, or was it, no, it was earlier this month, I think. Or was it last month? Maybe, I don't know. I was in court, and that's when one of the court clerks got on to me. I was like, Doc Bryce, you cannot have your hat on in court. And as I was reaching for my hat to take it off, that's when Chief was like, but he's Doc Bryce. And I'm like, yeah, hey, yeah, I'm Doc Bryce. And so I was just going to take it off. And then when Chief said that, I'm like, yeah, I don't have to take it off. And then here comes Buckshot, right? And I go, Buckshot's got his hat on. And everybody's looking at me like, but he's Buckshot. And I'm like, well, it is true. I am no Buckshot. But Buckshot can wear his hat. He can wear his cover and inside. That's okay. That's what made me think. It's like, you know, for a guy at his level of rank and the level of authority that he does have, it cracked me up to know that he could sit there and just bark at people. And they did it. Stand up. Everybody stood up. Sit down. Everybody sat down. Move over to one side. Everybody to the left, to the right. You know, that's what Buckshot does, and Buckshot can do it. So he opened the ceremony, or not opened the ceremonies, but, well, yeah, actually he kind of did, because he got everybody to stand up, and then we brought in Judge Foster, and everybody sat down. And then that's when Michael Fry went ahead and opened everything up. Vic pretty much emceed everything. Mayor came up, Mayor Lott came up, and also made a proclamation and explained that at City Council they had a resolution to honor Judge Foster, and of course it passed unanimously. And there were some other people there in the audience as well. Of course, Foster's family was there. And shoot, I can't think of his name. I see his face, but I can't think of his name. Christy Carr was there. And oh, dang it. Now I can't think of his name. He's a defense attorney. I know somebody out there just yelled it, but I can't think of his name. Of course, Chief Bo Woody got up. And also talked about how, you know, the characteristics and things about Judge Foster, how that portrayed down and carried down when it came to some of the officers, because, you know, they have to be in court to, if they, you know, when they arrest somebody, they've got to be in court, you know, testify or whatever. And, you know, they're before the judge too. And then they see how that judge operates his courtroom and everything. And pretty much everybody was in unison that Judge Foster was fair and just and compassionate. Strickland got up there. Joe Strickland got up there and because he got up there because Norwood was supposed to speak, your county sheriff. He got called out. And so Strickland got up there and spoke in place of the sheriff, and pretty much explained that, you know, as a bailiff, it's like, you know, I see you're going into retirement and everything, but dude, if you ever come out of retirement and you need a bailiff, call me. I will be there. I will be your bailiff. And then Christy Carr did get up there and speak as well. She gave her thoughts and also how Judge Foster is when it comes to ruling and everything. And then was it Singleton? Singleton got up there and spoke as well. So, I mean, you know, you had some judges up there and you had some locals there. James Woods, you know, from Woods Place, he got up there and spoke as well. He was like, oh, gosh, shucks. Norwood did make it back in and he spoke as well. Then Clayton, State Trooper Clayton, I'm trying to think of his last name. Is it Walker? Usually when I deal with officers, I always deal with a one name basis. So sometimes I don't know their other names, but, he came up and his deal was, he said that he learned through Foster by watching Foster and everything. He learned how to also be fair and just because, you know, these guys are out there enforcing the law. And then you get before the judge and the judge, you know, is the one who decides what part of the law applies and how that part of the law applies and what that means and what the outcome is going to be based on what the law is. So these law enforcers, law enforcement officers, that's what they do. They're enforcing the law. And when it comes to dealing with people out there in the streets and stuff that, you know, that when it comes to, and I've seen this firsthand too, especially with Camden Police Department and Wichita Sheriff's County Department. When it comes to dealing with the general public, I watched a guy ended up doing 82 miles an hour in a 55. And I was riding with one of the Wichita County Sheriff's deputies and we chased him. And we did, man. We booked it. I'm like, oh my gosh. And I'm getting all excited and everything. I'm like, oh my gosh, this is like cops TV, man. We're gonna bust somebody. Yeah, let's get him. You know, and then we're like running lights and everything. We catch up with him and finally we catch up with him. He's over at the gas station there off of Cash and 278, the spur bypass, whatever you want to call it. The one that's over there by, the gas station, it's not there now. It's closed, but it was open at the time. And it's right there in the corner where the old subway used to be inside. And so I watched and I observed and then come to find out the guy just got a warning. It's too close to Christmas. Nobody needs a ticket, especially for doing 86 or in a 55. Nobody needs a ticket for that. Not around Christmas time. That money should be used for buying presents and doing family stuff. And so that deputy had a talking to with the driver and was very compassionate and very fair and told the driver that, you know, I'm going to let you go. Just, you know, watch yourself, watch your speed, be careful out there. And this also reflects off of, you know, the sheriff. So if the deputies are doing it, well, then obviously this comes down from a higher authority, which would be the sheriff. And, you know, the sheriff has to work with the judge. And so, I mean, the sheriff's getting it from somewhere. So, I mean, you know, it's possible that you see it come down through the chain of everything. And that's where you get this compassion and stuff. And I watched them. We were doing those checkpoints. Popped two kids. They were drunk. And they hadn't done anything. They just they got caught. They were on their way to a duck blind, and it was early in the morning. And they hadn't hit any property. They haven't damaged any property. They haven't affected any lives. It just happened to be that at our little checkpoint, we caught them before they could do anyone any harm, including themselves. So I'm thinking, oh my gosh, this is terrible. You know, I mean, these kids are like 21. And bad things are going to happen, man. These kids are just starting out their lives, man. And they're going to have this DWI in their record. Oh, my gosh. Well, one's going to have a DWI. The other one's probably going to get a PI because only one can drive, right? But they're both drunk. And so what I saw was that they took the kids, the two guys, took them off to the side, gave them a good talking to, and asked them, is there anyone you can call? And so what happened was, they held them and would not let them drive because they were intoxicated. They're impaired to drive. And their parents showed up. So mom and dad showed up. And so that way you had one drive out there and then that way the other one can drive the truck back. And they gave them a talking to. It was a long, long lecture. And the parents got a long lecture as well. And the deputies explain how they didn't want to ruin these kids' lives because they're so young and getting a DWI on their record this young. They haven't damaged anything. They haven't affected anything. Luckily, they caught them when they did and was able to prevent anything from happening that would be bad to themselves or to someone else. And in this case, let's just count this as a blessing. Take care of the situation. Don't let it happen again. And that's compassion right there. Because, I mean, they could have, these two kids could have destroyed their life right there. And that would have been on their record for the longest time. And, you know, starting out 21, especially trying to get a job or something like that. I mean, it would just been a tailspin. Compassion. Let me take this break here. And we'll get into some other things here as well. Here on this Friday, News Talk 92, KBEU, the news and talk of South Arkansas. News Talk 92 KBEU, the news and talk of South Arkansas, as we are coming up on the top of the hour here, 7 o'clock almost already. 73 degrees outside, feels like 82, high of 97 today. And it's going to be warm out there, and it's going to be hot and humid too, so watch yourself. Make sure you stay hydrated, and watch for those cramps as well. You don't want to get heat exhaustion out there. That was one of, we were talking about Judge Foster here and his celebration and everything, and him being a judge and how awesome he is and all the judgy stuff that he does. One of the things I remember was, what do we call that thing? Amnesty? Was it the amnesty thing? Yeah. When we did amnesty, and that was really, really neat. This was all before COVID-19 broke out. But it was like night court. And one of the big things was, is a lot of people who end up getting infractions and things like that, or, you know, maybe of a low income or struggling out there between jobs and things like that. And they're trying to make ends meet and, you know, getting hit with a ticket, for, speeding, no insurance or anything like that, or out of date tags. You know, I mean, you're just trying to do what you can because, man, you were just, you've been there before, man. You're just trying everything that you can to do what you can with what you don't have to get to the next level. So, of course, that could put some people out there in a tailspin, too. And they end up, you know, getting hit with these fines and things like that that they can't afford. And they're like, I can't afford to pay this fine because, you know, I got to decide now. Do I get electricity or do I pay this fine and stay out of jail? Because if I don't pay the fine, then, of course, if I don't pay the fine, then a warrant goes out for my arrest and blah, 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 blah. And it's just a big tailspin. Now, with the amnesty program, what they did was they did this at night. So chances were it made it easier for people to come to court. And it gave them a second chance. And they got to go before the judge, which was Foster, and explain their situation and everything. And explain, you know, that they were there and this is what they got. And they did this and they did that and everything else. And basically, they would just throw themselves at the mercy of the court. And so the judge would end up listening to their story and everything. I'm sitting there in the galley, just kind of, observing and taking this all in. And next thing you know, he's reducing their charges. So he's saying, you know what? I'll go ahead and reset you here. So, you know, forget about the warrant's waived. Don't worry about the warrant. We will pick it off here. We'll drop these charges down by changing the charges or change the fines, drop the fines down by changing the charges to reduce the fines. And then we'll start you out at this price here. Can you make those payments? And so put them on a payment plan instead of saying, well, you know, it's a $500, $1,000 fee or something like that infraction. And instead of saying you got to pay it up here right now, they did like, well, how much can you afford to pay a month? You can do that much? You sure you could do that amount? Okay, then. And they would lock it in, sign off on it, and they would do it for that amount. So, you know, these people were able to get that warrant dropped get everything reset and get put on a better payment plan that they can afford and keep up with, and gave these people a second chance to be able to do what they needed to do. That's compassion, man. That's what that is. So, I mean, you know, and that was really neat that that we were able to do that as a city and a county. And because of COVID, that pretty much killed it. But COVID killed a lot of things, too, didn't it? So who knows? Maybe one day when things settle down, we can bring back amnesty. And that would be really awesome. Come to find out, though, we lost Judge Grant. David Grant. Yeah. Grant. Judge Grant. He was the one that was elected. He was out of Columbia County. And he was the one that was elected to take Judge Foster's place because, you know, Foster went into retirement. And so, was it David Grant? Am I saying that right? I don't feel like I'm saying that right. But anyhow, that judge was going to do district court for Columbia and Ouachita, kind of like combine the two together. Well, he ended up getting bumped to circuit court, which now leaves the chair empty. or the bench empty, I guess you would say. And now we don't have anybody for district court. So that means the governor is going to have to appoint somebody for district court and to fill that position until the next election cycle, and we can elect a judge to fill that position. So whoever gets that position to whoever gets appointed for that position by the governor will not be able to run out of that position, meaning that, they're there filling in that position by appointment, but they cannot run for that position. So it's got to be somebody that just isn't interested in taking the job. So they'll just basically fill the void until election cycle. And then from there, we'll elect a new judge to take over for district court. So that's where we're at. It's not Judge David Grant, is it? I don't know. That name still bothers me. I don't think I'm saying it right. Am I saying it right? I can't. Who is a... I can't tell. Wait a minute, man. Hang on. Is it, I know he's out of Columbia, but, Graham. See, I told you it didn't feel right. David Graham. That's the judge that was elected, to take over for Foster when, Foster retired. So he was out of, Columbia, Magnolia there, and, doing both. So he gets moved over to circuit judge, and that now leaves the district court open. And so the governor will appoint someone to fill that position until we can hold another election and elect a judge to take over. So, that's good. I mean, that's good. It kind of stinks, but it's good. You know, it's kind of one of those things there. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. David Graham will be going over to circuit court, which, you know, I guess, is that like an upgrade? Is that like a promotion? I'm circuit judge now. I used to be a district judge, but now I'm a circuit judge. I'm moving up in the world. Maybe, I guess. There's Supreme Court, right? I mean, you got your state Supreme Court and you got federal Supreme Court. It's like moving up the ranks, right? I guess. I don't know. I don't know how this judgy stuff works other than they're just so judgy. They're so judgmental. And then banging their gavel and everything and telling you how it's going to be. And it's going to be this way because I said so. Doggone it. As decreed by me, the judge, I decided that this boy is guilty. Send him to the chair. And that's when the mayor comes in. You can't send this boy to jail. He's innocent, I tell you. Anyhow, that's a Bugs Bunny cartoon clip. So anyhow. That's where that's at. It was a great time, and congratulations to Judge Foster and everything, and I hope you enjoy your retirement. And a new chapter in life as well. He says that he's got new things, that new goals and things that he's shooting for. So it's not like, he's just going to sit at home and watch Jeopardy. He's got plans. Man's got plans. All right, we got to take this break. Top of the hour news and more all right here. News Talk 92, KBEU, the news and talk of South Arkansas. News Talk 92 KBEU, the news and talk of South Arkansas. I hate talking over this. I just like the way it transitions, man. It's a good mix right there. Had to chop it up and everything. That's how you get around a copyright right there. There's no lyrics. It's the middle of the song towards the tail end of the song. You start out with the front and you kind of mix it up there, chop it up and everything. Yeah, chop shop for music. And that way you get around a copyright. But the algorithms, man. See, it works for radio, and we don't have to pay the ASCAP BMI, but it seems that I guess the algorithms or whatever are different on social media, and the rules don't apply there. And I'm like, look, man, if the FCC says that we can, if ASCAP BMI FCC says that we can do it here, then we can do it there. And they're like, nah, man, different policies and stuff, man. I'm like, whatever. I tell you what, man, social media puts us under more restrictions than the FCC does. And I mean, I thought the FCC was pretty harsh about the do's and don'ts and cans and can-ots that you could do in radio. And you would think that you could get away with a lot more on social media because you're not as regulated like you are in radio. And come to find out, just saying that men are dogs, I mean, you get slapped from Facebook. Next thing you know, you're in jail because you, that's a hate speech. And you're like, what? I was joking that men are like dogs, you know? I mean, you put good food out, they'll hang out on your front porch for a while until somebody else puts better food out, and then they'll move down the street. But they always come back, always come back. And that was hate speech because you were comparing a human to less than human or subhuman by comparing them to an animal. And I'm like, you big dummies, we're all animals. The only difference is we can deny our instinct and we have opposable thumbs. Unlike, you know, the primates, because they have opposable thumbs. They got opposable thumbs on their feet, too. How cool is that? We don't have that. Raccoons have opposable thumbs. But you know who built this world? We did. Not the primates and not the raccoons either. Yeah, none of them built none of this stuff with their opposable thumbs. We did, because we're humans and we can deny our instinct. Hurrah. Yeah. Primal. Raw. Anyhow. Don't mean to be on that kick, but yeah, I even argued that. I was like, you know, we're animals too, right? Human species is also considered animals and stuff. Nope. Supposedly, I don't know. It's Facebook, man. They're stupid. Facebook is stupid. With their stupid fact checkers and everything over there that sits there and tells you that people, that is incorrect. People do not collect bacon grease and save it. That's stupid. You're stupid. Your post is stupid. We're going to restrict you and what people can see of your stupid post. And you're like, yeah, it did. It actually did save bacon grease and stuff. I got a can right here. Yeah, stuff and things. Anyhow. So we've been speaking about law enforcement. We've been speaking about words and how they're used. And we've been congratulating Judge Foster in his retirement and his next chapter in life and everything else. And we've been talking about, hey, what makes you a cop? Well, that don't make you a cop, but this makes you a cop, but that don't make you a cop. Well, we've got some cops that are now cops. I guess they're cops now because they're hitting the streets, man. There they go. They're new recruits. Actually, I guess they're not cops because they're considered state police recruits. See how they worded that? They didn't say state police officers. They said state police recruits receive their trooper commissions. So the graduates were among the initial of, 227 applied for this job. And out of that, only 21 were sworn under oath. Wait, they're sworn under oath. That makes them cops now, right? So they're cops because they're sworn in. Because that's what my badge said. And my badge says that I am not a sworn employee of the city of Camden. So that would mean that I'm not sworn in, which means I'm not a cop. Now, you'd be amazed at how many people are inside that cop shop over there that are not cops. They're just employees. They're like the support guys that make the cops look good. Yeah, they don't get any credit for it, though. Yes, ladies, the thin gold line. Yes, the dispatchers out there. They are the eyes, ears, and heart of every police officer out there. Because without them, these officers would be in the dark and have no idea what was going on and could also put them in a grave danger of all kinds of situations. So it's thanks to that thin gold line out there. It's these ladies and gentlemen, too, who are dispatchers out there that make it possible for these cops to be able to safely do their job as safely as possible. Anyhow, 21 recruits were sworn in under oath Thursday night as Arkansas State Troopers. And they were all sworn in by North Little Rock District Judge Randy Morley, Lieutenant Colonel Sean Garner, Deputy Director of Enforcement of the Arkansas State Police, and Jamie Cook, Secretary of the Arkansas Department of Public Safety, addressed the class. And State Police Senior Command Staff Troop and Company Commanders Training Section Carde and Arkansas State Police Commissioners were among those attending the graduation. So these guys will be reporting to their respective assignments across the state. So you're thinking, what, North Little Rock, what's that got to do with us? Because they may be coming to a town near you. So if you start seeing new troopers out there and you're like, hey, I don't know that guy. This guy's never pulled me over before. Who's this guy? Look, if you're familiar with law enforcement because of your interaction with law enforcement in a negative way, that's not good. We shouldn't be laughing about that. Now, if it's in a good situation, I guess mine would be a good situation. Because I tell you what, there's nothing that'll turn heads faster when you walk into a restaurant and you walk past a table of cops sitting there eating lunch and all of them look up and wave and you go, hey, doc. And then, you know, everybody's like looking at you like a, all them cops know that dude. Who's that dude? It can be a good feeling, and then it can be like, oh, we shouldn't eat here. Let's go to the other restaurant. So anyhow, they'll begin reporting to their respective assignments across the state. So if you see one around here, I guess welcome them aboard. I don't know. I wouldn't be doing that if I got pulled over. Hey, you look new to me, man. Welcome. Are you one of the newbies? So they'll receive an additional 5 to 9 weeks of instruction working alongside field training officers before being released from their training regimen. So congratulations, all y'all out there, you 21 guys who made it out of a class of 227, or at least out of 227 applicants, 21 made it to the end there. And so now they are going to be hitting the streets and becoming super troopers. Also, hey, man, like if you're doing online dating stuff, woman over in Pine Bluff. Yeah, she got the little crap beaten out of her. And Rob, too, because she met someone online on social media. I'm just saying. Now, I say this, and of course, you know, we're talking about the ladies out there. So we're saying, hey, ladies, you know, y'all need to be safe and stuff. Men, no different. You don't know. It could be a guy out there just trying to take advantage of a situation. Because trust me, when it comes to these love cons and things like that, you got these little ladies hitting you going, hey, baby, I saw your profile. You sure are looking. Oh, hang on here. Let me do this right. Hey, baby, I saw your profile picture. I see you looking all fine and everything, baby. Let me send you some pictures. And then they send you pictures, and you're like, wow, she's hot. Yeah, baby, I'm hot. And I got all kinds of things. I'm going to make you hotter. Now, I do that with a male voice because it's typically a guy on the other side pretending to be a lady. And then a lot of guys fall for that, too. And they get stuck into these love cons and everything. And sometimes they give up money because they're like, oh, I need to pay my interwebs or we can't talk anymore. And then, you know, the guy's like sending money over or whatever, or going to Walmart and getting gift cards and everything else. So that way she can buy tampons. I actually had one hit me up, said that she was desperate for money because she needed tampons. And then she would also like to continue talking with me over the interwebs and need to pay her internet bill. Like, have a good day, block. Sorry about your luck. Find a t-shirt. Dude, man, I mean, it's all cons and stuff. So sometimes you can get lucky and you can catch them. Oh, yeah, we're done with that. She's done. We blocked her. So anyhow, a lot of times, you know, you can see these things coming a mile away and you block them and, you know, you don't lose any money. You keep your dignity and everything else. And then other times, you know, you're on these dating online apps, you know, POF. What's the other ones? POF, you got Tinder, you've got, what is that, Oklahoma thing or whatever, and then you've got Facebook dating and all this other stuff. I mean, you got all different kinds of platforms out there when it comes to online dating. And I say, ladies, you know, be careful out there, but men, be careful too, man, because you never know when you're going to go meet someone and it's a bunch of dudes that are going to overtake you, beat the crap out of you, and take your wallet and run off with your vehicle. You just don't know. I mean, we laugh, but you just don't know. It, as far as you know of, it is a chick on the other side. But a lot of times it's dudes that you're talking to and professing your love to. So anyhow, this woman over in Pine Bluff, she says she got beaten and robbed in her home earlier this week by someone she met on social media. She's 23 years old. Her name's Aileen Wallace. And she says the man who beat her left her with a broken nose. She had to get stitches as well. So she said when she was looking in the mirror, she didn't recognize herself. And she's speaking out on her experience with hopes of preventing this to happen to other women. And I'm telling you, it can happen to men, too. She was in fear of her life. She actually thought dude was going to kill her. She says the man tased her in her neck, followed by choking her. Then she reached for her gun. You hear this? She reached for her gun. But it says that he took it and then beat her in the head with it until she gave him her wallet. You hear what I'm saying? So with tears running down her swollen eyes and everything, Wallace says that she blames herself for the pain that she endures by letting a stranger enter her home. That's the other thing too, people, guys, as well as women. Women as well as guys. Don't ever give up your address to a stranger. Don't be sitting there going, oh yeah, I live around here. A lot of times, man, I will screw with these people and they'll be like, Hang on. So, big boy, where do you live? I live in, and then I think about it, Ohio. I try and go over. I'm not telling them I'm in Arkansas. Oh, that's hot. I like Ohio. Do you like Ohio? Oh, I love living in Ohio.
Yeah. Well, I'm in Ohio, too.
I bet you are. I bet you're right down the street from me, too.
I'm right down the street from you.
That's what I thought. Yeah, I ain't nowhere near Ohio. You know I'm not in Ohio. Listen, you listeners, y'all know I am not in Ohio. I'm in Arkansas. And then they'll be like,
send me a picture, baby. Send me a picture of yourself.
So I'll just randomly go find some dude on the internet. I know. Yeah, some of you are going, why do you even bother, Doc? And I'm like, I'm bored. I'm a single guy. I got nothing going on. And, you know, if it ain't work, I'm at home. And if it ain't home, I'm at work. And so when I'm at home and I got nothing to do, sometimes I sit there and I'm watching Netflix and, you know, my phone thing will go off. And, you know, I'm just sitting there minding my business, watching some, you know, love story about saving the gazebo in the town next to the Christmas tree farm at the end. And I'm like, ooh. And then I look and I was like, oh, look.
Hey, baby, I saw your profile thing.
And there we go. And we're off to the races. And so when you're sitting at home, you know, I mean, you get bored watching that many, you know, save the gazebo, love romance, screw it up, then discover yourself and save the Christmas tree farm while you're at the inn, all in one shot. So, I mean, you know, sometimes, you know, you're just sitting there because it's something to do. You know, ooh, there it is.
Hey, baby.
So you start messing with them. And sometimes, I don't know, it's just kind of fun to sit there and mess with them back. And then sit there and send them pictures and everything of someone that's not you. Because then they keep, and it's what's funny, I guess I'm not supposed to realize that they keep sending me pictures and it's not the same girl. Like, I don't know, like, I guess I'm girl blind or something. All I see is, you know, boobies or whatever. And so I can't recognize the face because I'm like, that's not the same girl. And I'm like, I wonder if they'll realize that's not the same guy. So I just send them different. They send me different pics of girls. I send them different pics of guys. And I'm not sure if that actually works out to where they realize that, hey, that's not the where they're going. Hey, wait a minute. That's not the same guy. Because they keep going because they're like, well, because they're like,
oh, yeah, baby, that's hot. Yeah, send me more pictures.
And what it's getting down to, see, that's the other thing you got to be careful, too, with sextortion. Well, yeah, because what they're doing, why would you send some stranger a picture of yourself so they can see what you look like? Seriously, it'd be as dumb as giving him your address. I mean, why not just have them show up on your front porch? Seriously. So you don't send them pictures of yourself. You don't give them anything identifiable to yourself. Don't tell them what street you live on because they may use that as a security point. You know, because, you know, like the security questions, you know, like what street do you live on? Well, I live on this street. And, yeah, it could be one of the security questions. Anyhow, the thing is you don't want to be giving out all this information and everything. And especially when it comes to sending pictures and stuff, because what's going to end up happening is they're going to start asking you for like they're going to start, you know, that we make fun of the
hey, baby.
But what's eventually going to happen is it's going to turn into, hey, I want you to send me a full-blown picture of yourself, of all your naughty bits, baby, from head to toe. And you're like, do what?
I want all your naughty bits, baby. Send me a picture, a nude of yourself from head to toe. I want to see your face and I want to see your toes.
And you're like, wait a minute, what? And so, because this person has got you all worked up and everything,
I really think you hot and gorgeous.
And what do? Like a, pretty much like a dumb, you send it anyways. And then next thing you know, they got your picture. And this goes from this to nightmare. Because now they're extorting you and saying they want cash and everything. Or they're going to send this picture, that this naughty picture that you just sent them to all your friends on your friend list. You'd be amazed. You'd just be amazed. I've actually had women ask for, they've actually asked me for a pic, you know, of a eggplant. And I'm like, okay. And so I'll send them like pictures of my microphone. I'm like, that's big, ain't it, baby? Yeah. Look how big my microphone is. Oh, yeah. You see that mic screen on there? Step up to the mic, baby. Yeah. And then they get mad because they're like, that's not what I mean. So anyhow, be careful out there when it comes to online stuff, man. Just use some common sense. All right, I got to take this break. Roundtable up next. News Talk 92. KBU, the news and talk of South Arkansas.